What's the connection between land management and this ratty pair of underwear? A healthier planet. Now, it might seem weird, but burying a pair of 100% cotton underwear and digging it up 60 days later can help determine how healthy soil is. If it's in rags and decomposed, it probably means your soil is healthy. And that's because cotton is an organic material that should decompose under the right conditions. And that means plenty of soil microbes. If the underwear is intact, it can mean that your soil is deficient. Having healthy soil is important because it's linked to higher crop yields, cleaner air, and better water quality. It helps reduce erosion, flooding, and stormwater runoff into local streams, which can contain fertilizers from farmland. This can lead to dead zones in aquatic ecosystems. Oh, and let's not forget that healthy soil also helps sequester carbon from the atmosphere. But how do you fix unhealthy soil? Well, through regenerative agriculture. And it looks like this. Regenerative agriculture can be broadly understood as a set of farming practices that could help restore biodiversity, fight climate change, and spark economic development. According to some advocates, regenerative farming should be a priority in the fight against climate change. So, I want to know, how easy is it to transition into regenerative farming? Is it the same practice for every farm? And is it something that we could scale around the world? Let's find out. On this episode of Can It Save the Planet, I will tour the Shrack Farms with Jim Harbeck to learn more about regenerative farming practices, its challenges, impacts.
It all comes back to the farm, and it all comes back to regenerating these soils so that they can function the way Mother Nature intended them to.
And ultimately find out if regenerative agriculture can save the planet.
Presented by Cotton.
In 2020, agriculture accounted for 11% of the US's greenhouse gas emissions. But as much as it's impacting our climate, agriculture could also be our solution. One estimate projects that an expansion of regenerative farming could result in a global net reduction of 15 to 23 gigatons of CO2 by 2050. In the US, it's projected that regenerative practices across 85% of cropland could sequester approximately 100 million metric tons of carbon dioxide annually. Depending on where you look, you'll get various definitions of what regenerative agriculture really is. So, based on all my research, here's the best way of defining it. Creating and implementing farming practices in harmony with nature that restore and improve soil health while helping us reduce carbon emissions, reduce pesticide use, and yield healthier crops. Some of those practices include,
number one, no-till planting. Leaving land untilled helps to not disturb the soil in order to reduce erosion and help water properly permeate into the land. Number two, cover cropping. Planting temporary crops that are not for harvest helps to keep the soil fertile, prevent erosion, and also reduce water runoff, which causes pollution. Number three, animal integration. There are lots of techniques for using livestock in regenerative farming, from moving cattle around for grazing techniques to using their manure to fertilize the soil. And number four, diversity crop rotations. Having diverse crops is important to avoid monocultures and limit pesticide use.
In modern practices, regenerative farming could consist of all practices, a combination of two or three, or modified versions of each. Over the past couple years, regenerative agriculture has gained popularity with books, articles, and even documentaries on Netflix. Even big companies are taking note. In 2019, General Mills announced that it's investing in regenerative agriculture across 1 million acres of farmland. Although it's getting more popular, it's not being implemented at the same rate. After all, there are around 12 million acres of agriculture land globally, so scalability could be an issue. However, it's important to note this idea is not new. Regenerative farming practices are rooted in indigenous communities' relationship with the land. But through the years, farming has become extremely industrialized, taking us further and further away from nature's way. I'm now visiting the Shrack Farms in Pennsylvania and talking to Jim Harbeck to get a first-hand look at the regenerative practices.
Remember that cotton underwear I dug up at the top of the episode? That was here, on Jim's farm. His family has been practicing regenerative methods, like no-till farming, since the 70s.
Tell me more about regenerative agriculture and what it means to you.
For us, regenerative agriculture means trying to get the soils back to a condition where they once were. It's about taking soils that no longer infiltrate water and no longer have much biology life in it and restoring that.
Jim says his farm has been no-tilling for nearly 50 years and cover cropping for nearly 20 years.
To be honest with you, we did all those for the wrong reason. When you run a plow in these shallow soils, you bring up a lot of stones. So for us, it was about trying to not pick stones. I remember soils that when you plowed them, they had lumps the size of a softball or even bigger. Today, we could take you to that same field and it would be soft dirt. That's what 40-some years of no-till has done. And then the cover crops really added to that and sped up that process.
As for animal integration, the Schrack farm is a dairy farm, so they found a different way to be sustainable with their livestock.
We don't pasture animals here, but we process the manure. We have a screw press that takes the solids out, and the liquid portion of it goes to a storage place where the goal would be to apply that to a growing crop.
As for the methane produced from digesting the manure, that also gets reused by running it through an engine and converting it into electricity.
The electricity is used on the farm, plus we export quite a bit of electricity that's sold back to the grid. The heat that the engine creates, we also capture that and use it for numerous things within the dairy, and one would be it heats our domestic hot water. You're essentially keeping everything cycled and not bringing in other materials that would have a larger carbon footprint and a bigger expense for the dairy.
As Jim said, his farm didn't start doing regenerative farming for planetary health reasons. But since seeing the benefits, he's trying to help other farmers see the connection between sustainable practices and the planet.
The biggest challenge is the mindset change. A lot of farmers have been doing it the same way for a lot of years. That's how my father did it, my grandfather, and they're not really willing to change. But once they start to see the benefits from it, you can't ignore them. I haven't met a farmer yet that didn't want to be environmentally responsible. You gotta have a mindset to make it work. It's not easy and it's not cheap. And unfortunately, a lot of the digesters that are built in this country usually start at 200 to 300 cows in size to make them feasible. But I know in other countries, in Sweden and places like that, they have a digester on every farm, just about any size. They figured out how to make it work.
Got it. So regenerative farming can be high reward, but it can also be high cost and not necessarily feasible for all farmers. It's been extremely helpful to see some of these practices in person, but it seems these practices are too nuanced and don't provide a clear, measurable solution. Before I get to the root of our question, I want to take a moment to thank Cotton for sponsoring this episode. Cotton encourages consumers to always check the label and choose natural fibers like cotton. Not only is cotton strong, soft, and hyperallergenic, but it's also plant-based. Natural fiber is long-lasting, biodegradable, and doesn't shed microplastics into waterways. Also, we see it on everyone, from wardrobe basics to high fashion. To learn more about cotton, visit thefabricoferlives.com. Now, back to the episode.
Let's do a quick recap of what we learned so far. Number one, regenerative farming can be interpreted in many different ways around the world. Number two, it has multiple benefits like sequestering carbon and reducing water pollution. And number three, it can take years to transition a farm. The proof of regenerative agriculture keeping our water clean is there. For example, the Stradwater Research Center and the Rodale Institute's Watershed Impact Trial, which is running for 6 years to demonstrate how different agricultural practices impact things like crop yields, stream water quality, soil quality, and infiltration. But when it comes to sequestering carbon, there is some doubt. The numbers I mentioned up top regarding how much CO2 can be sequestered with regenerative practices are mostly projections. Actually measuring the carbon can be a bit tricky. For example, farmers that practice no-till agriculture might end up plowing their soils every few years regardless, which would reverse the short-term soil carbon benefit accrued through no-till practices. As mentioned before, scalability is also an issue. Farmers could run into a combination of obstacles, whether it's financially being unable to implement, climate implications like heat waves or droughts, or simply not having enough time. But according to one study conducted in Iowa, wider adaptation has been difficult because of cost and limited time to establish cover crops before winter begins. So, can regenerative agriculture save the planet? Well, it's tricky. Not currently. From what I've learned, regenerative farming seems too nuanced to be deemed a viable solution on its own. But don't get me wrong, all of these practices highlighted in this episode are great for the environment and should be implemented where possible. There are case studies in which these practices have worked. Everything from farmers' crop yields being 20 to 25% higher than average to land retaining enough water to survive a dry summer. Jim's farm, for example, is a good success story. According to Jim, his yields have increased over the past 2 decades, his farm runs on self-generated, methane-based electricity, and they haven't used insecticides on crops for over 20 years. So we should look at those examples as inspiration on how regenerative agriculture could reduce costs, reduce contaminated surface runoff, and help with water conservation. So as Jim said, it all has to begin with the mind change for most of us. Or, you know, by burying a pair of underwear in your soil. Methane. You're gonna use this as a blooper, aren't you?